Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Welcome to the session of course Therapeutic Nutrition. This is the fourth module, that is etiology, clinical features and nutritional management of weight imbalances. And in this lecture, we shall be studying about nutritional management of overweight. I am Dr. Jaspreet Kaur, presently working as Assistant Professor in Government College for Girls, Ludhiana, Punjab, affiliated to Punjab University, Chandigarh. And this project is funded by DTH Swayam Prabha, MHRD, New Delhi. So in the first lecture, we had studied about the basics of body composition. And we studied that according to two compartment model, the body can be divided into fat mass and fat-free mass. And then we studied about adipose tissues, their structure, their location, and their types. And after that, we studied about regulation of body weight, that is short-term regulation and long-term regulation. And then we moved to overweight, in which we studied about the etiology of overweight. So moving ahead with overweight, in this lecture, we will study about theories of overweight, and then we will study what are the clinical features of overweight and obesity, and then we will see how we can assess overweight or obesity, and then finally we will study about the types of obesity. Now let us study about some theories which indicate that why some people they are of normal weight and some become overweight or obese. Why overweight people they are overweight? So let us study the first theory, that is fat cell theory. According to this theory, the adipocytes can be distributed throughout the body, forming a reserve of depot of energy, which is very elastic in nature. And this depot can expand in two ways, that is either by increase in number of fat cells or by increase in the size of the fat cell, as we have already studied this thing in our previous lecture also. So according to this theory, the number of fat cells which are partly influenced by the genetic inheritance and partly by our eating habits. So the number of fat cells, they are determined early in the life. And once these cells are formed, they have a tendency to stay full of fats. So hypertrophy, it can increase the fat depots as much as 1000 times of the size. And the hyperplasia, it can occur mainly during the growth periods, and it may also occur at any time when the fat cells, they reach their maximum size and they cannot grow anymore. So increase in the adipose tissue causing weight gain can be because of hyperplasia, it could be because of hypertrophy, or it could be because of both of the hyperplasia and hypertrophy. There is another theory, we call it set point theory. According to this theory, the individual regulates the amount of body fat that they normally have. So each person, they have ideal biological weight or a set point. Now, once that body weight reaches this point, the whole set of signals is produced that influence a person intake to maintain his weight, and it will resist any kind of change in its comfortable weight. So this theory indicates that an overweight person's body will resist any weight loss effort by the person. So coming to the clinical features of overweight and obesity, it could be when the body weight of the person is grossly above the acceptable or desirable weight, usually due to accumulation of excess body fat. And secondly, it could be excessively high accumulation of body fat in relation to lean body mass. A lean body mass is the protein part of our body. And thirdly, it could be along with higher accumulation of overall fat, the concerns are also for what is the distribution of fat in the body, whether it is distributed all over the body or it is distributed more in the central part of the body. And lastly, we are concerned clinically to see what is the size of adipocyte deposits inside the body. Now let's learn about the assessment of over and obesity. As we know, visual inspection that gives a subjective but fairly accurate estimate of degree of overweight or obesity. When we talk about body weight, we have some reference tables which indicates what are the average weights by height and age. Then we get tables for a desirable weight for height. And if a person is weighing 10% more than the standard weight, he is considered overweight. And if he is 20% higher than the ideal body weight, we call that person as obese person. So let us see, this is one of the table which can be helpful in calculating the ideal body weight. So let us take an example of a medium built woman. For a woman, we have to allow 100 pounds, that is 45.5 kilograms, for his first 5 feet of height. And then we will add 5 pounds or 2.3 kilograms for each additional inch of her height. And for men, we have similar equations. And if the lady is of smaller frame, we will subtract 10% of the weight which we calculate. If she is having large frame, then we will add 10% to calculate the ideal body weight. So now let us understand it with the help of an example. So we have studied that allow 100 pounds for first 5 feet of the height, and plus we have to add 5 pounds or 2.3 kg for each additional inch. Now let us take an example of a female who is 5.4 inches height, that means 5 feet and 4 inches tall. So ideal body weight calculation would be 45.5 kg, that is for first 5 feet, and since she is 4 inches more, so it will be 2.3 kg into 4, and we get 45.5 plus 9.2, that means 54.7 kg is her ideal body weight. Then we have Broca's index, which is fairly easy to calculate and it is accurate also. Here, how we calculate? We see what is the height in the centimeter and we deduct 100 out of it and we get ideal body weight in kilograms. So let us understand it with the help of an example. For example, height is 164 centimeter and we will subtract 100. What we get is 64. So the ideal body weight for that person is 64 kgs. So once we have understood what is the ideal body weight of a person and we are able to calculate the ideal body weight for ourselves, we can always assess the overweight or obesity. How to calculate? Let's see. We call a person to be as overweight when his weight is 10% more than the ideal body weight. And a person will be termed obese when he is having 20% or more weight than ideal body weight. And this is a table which will indicate the degree of the obesity. If the body weight in excess to normal is more than 25%, we call that person as mild obesity. And if the person is 50% heavier than the normal ideal body weight, then that person is moderately obese. And if the person weighs 75% more than his ideal body weight, that person is severely obese. And if he is weighing 100% more than his normal ideal body weight, that person is extremely obese. So body mass index or BMI, it is considered as a better estimate of body fatness and health risk than the body weight alone. And it is also known as Quetelet's index. It is a helpful tool while assessing a large group of people, as it will correlate with the body fat composition. But it has a limitation that it cannot distinguish between overweight due to obesity and overweight or higher BMI due to muscular hypertrophy. Such as in athletes, they will show higher BMI, but it is because of they have more muscle mass, but the BMI cannot distinguish that. So now let us understand how to calculate body mass index. We calculate BMI by taking weight in kilograms and dividing by the height in meter square. So taking an example, if the person is having 70 kgs weight and his height is 5 feet and 4 inches, that amounts to 64 inches. If we convert into centimeters, it will come out to be 162.56 centimeter, and if we convert into meter, it will come out to be 1.62 meter. So the formula says weight in kilograms divided by height in meter square. So weight in kilogram, we have seen it is 70. So height in meter square, it was 1.62 into 1.62. So what we get is 26.71. So that person has 26.71 as body mass index. So now let us see how to interpret this body mass index. So according to World Health Organization, the classification of overweight person is anywhere between 25 to 29.9 is considered overweight. And for obesity, we have three classes or the grades. The grade 1 obesity is anywhere between 30 to 34.9, and grade 2 obesity is 35 to 39.9, and a person who is having BMI more than 40 is considered as extreme obese. But here we have some Indian consensus, as we people with lower BMI are also more prone to other non-communicable diseases. So that is why, according to Indian consensus, we consider that the overweight person is with BMI between 23 to 24.9. And if a person is between 25 to 29.9, we call that person grade 1 obese. And if the person is having 30 to 34.9, he'll be grade 2 obese, and anywhere which is higher than 35, that person will be considered as extremely obese in Indian setting. So let's understand what are the grades of obesity. How do we grade overweight and obesity? As we have already seen that the grade 1 obesity is anywhere 25 to 29, and this person may lead normal life. When that person gains more weight and his BMI reaches anywhere between 30 to 39.9, we call it grade 2 obesity, and this person needs medical assistance, and this person is at higher risk of getting non-communicable diseases. And this is followed by further weight gain, which will cause grade 3 obesity, which will correspond to BMI above 40. And this person will need medical assistance, which is susceptible to non-communicable diseases also. And this person will be susceptible to accidents, and psychological disturbances also. Measurement of waist circumference is a very practical tool in clinical setup, and it will actually help to evaluate patients or a person who is having abdominal obesity. So here we can divide the population in two groups. We call it action level 1 and action level 2. If a person has waist circumference more than 72 centimeter, in case we talk about women, and a male who is having the waist more than 78 centimeter, we always say that they need to go in for maintenance kind of diet, and they should avoid gaining weight any further. And then that is followed by action level 2. Here, when the woman, the waist circumference is higher than 80 centimeter and it is more than 90 centimeter in case of man, the person is advised to go for medical advice so that some intervention can be done to avoid occurrence of any non-communicable disease because of abdominal fat. We can assess the body fat percentage of a person through some methods, such as we can go for skin fold thickness to measure the subcutaneous fat with the help of calipers. And we can always interpret the amount of body fat percent, and we can correlate it with the weight status of that person. So if a person has a body fat between 12 to 20%, in case of a male, we call it normal. And in case of female, anywhere between 20 to 30%, we call it normal. But when it goes higher than 20, that means ranging from 21 to 25 in case of males, and 31 to 33% in case of female, we call it borderline obesity. But once it crosses 25% in case of males and crosses 33% in case of female, we call them person as obese. So these are some methods to estimate the body fat percent. We call it dual X-ray absorptometry, which is more widely accepted method measuring body composition. It is safe, convenient, and non-invasive. And it can actually measure the fat percentage with great precision, and it correlates well with the other methods measuring the composition. And then another instrument, it is called body fat analyzer. We call it bioelectrical impedance analyzer, which gives us body fat percentage along with the other components of the body. So along with that, then we have another equation. We call it Duerenberg equation. So according to this equation, the formula is percentage body fat is equal to, this is an equation, 1.2 into body mass index plus 0.23 into age in year minus 10.8 into g minus 5.4. Here G stands 1 for male and G stands 0 for a female. So for example, if the person has BMI 26, the age is 21 years and G is female, G means gender. So let us understand what the calculation comes out. So the percentage of body weight according to this parameter is, so it says 1.2 into BMI. So it is 1.2 into 26 was the BMI plus 0.23 into age in year. So the age of that person is 21 years minus 10.8 into the G. G here, since she is a female, so we'll put 0 minus 5.4. So according to Duerenberg's equation, the percentage body weight comes out to be 30.6%. So this it gives a fairly accurate measure of percent body fat. So according to this equation, the males anywhere between 20 to 25% or more, they are at risk, and female anywhere after 25 to 32% more fat, they are at risk. Waist to hip ratio is another reliable index of adiposity of a person. The predominant distribution of fat in obese person, whether in the upper part or the lower part of the body, that will determine the disease pattern also. So the abdominal obesity may not go hand in hand with the overall overweight and obesity. So when we talk about waist to hip ratio, we always say the normal waist hip ratio should be 0.7. So if it is more than 8.5 in women or more than 1 in males, the person is considered more prone to getting the diseases associated with overweight and obesity. And along with that, regional distribution of adipose tissue is very important to know when we are talking about overweight and obesity. So here we have one distribution, we call it android or male pattern of fat distribution. Here the fat is distributed predominantly in the upper part of the body, that is above the waist portion. So the person will have more fat in the upper part of the body. And then the second type of distribution is called gynecoid or female pattern. Here the fat distribution is predominantly in the lower abdomen or the buttocks or hips or thigh region. It is also known as pear shape. This shape is known as apple shape. And obesity related to the central abdominal parts, it is associated with the metabolic derangements, like it will cause insulin resistance, hyperinsulinemia, then non-insulin diabetes mellitus, dyslipidemia and hypertension. Now let us study about the types of obesity. Obesity can be of two types. The first type is known as juvenile onset obesity. It occurs due to hyperplasia, which is happening more rapidly in the first few years of life. There will be marked increase in the adipose tissue cells. That is why we call it hyperplastic obesity. There will be too many calories pumped in the infant or during the early childhood. This will lead to overproduction of fat cells. And this will be followed by hypertrophy. The fat cells, once produced, they shall not disappear. So the obese children, they are inclined to become obese adults. So the second type of obesity is known as adult onset obesity, and it is also known as hypertrophic obesity. So here the size of cells, that is greatly enlarged, and a distended adipose cell, this will lead to further many physiological, biochemical and anatomical aberrations in the organ and organ systems, thereby damaging, and this will be led to many lifestyle diseases also. So let's summarize what we have studied in this second lecture. We started with the clinical features of overweight or obese person, where the body weight is grossly above the acceptable or the desirable weight. Secondly, it could be excessively high accumulation of body fat in relation to the lean body mass, that is our muscle mass. And along with that, we also studied that higher size of adipose depots and the type of distribution of fat inside the body, they are also taken into account whenever we are studying the clinical features of an overweight or obese person. Then we studied that how we can use Broca's index or use reference weight or height tables to calculate our ideal body weight. Then we studied that assessment of overweight, which is done with the help of body weight in relation to height from reference charts, or we can use the help of a body mass index. We can use waist circumference. Then we can calculate waist to hip ratio. We can always use certain equations like Durenberg equation, and we can also use body fat analyzers to assess the total body fat percentage for its interpretation. And then we studied about the distribution of fat in our body in android and gynecoid type of obesity. And then we studied that obesity, it could be juvenile or adult onset. We shall continue this topic in our next lecture. Thank you.